When we started our conversations about this panel, I quite naturally, as most of you would do, I would refer to Jeff and to Heather and to Mr. Justice. And David Souter, being who he is, would say, no, don't call me David. So I call him now Mr. Justice David. And the reason I do that, democracy is about process. It's not about policy outcomes. Democracy is about process. And process is about institutions. And to have a successful democracy, you have to have successful institutions that carry out their functions well, that earn the respect of the people, and therefore make the people comfortable with the system in which they live and in which they are willing to participate. I might say here that I'm a little reluctant to talk about politics with an expert like Sandy Levinson here or my old colleague at the Kennedy School, Francis, here, you know, but I will try not to repeat everything they've heard me say before. But when we talk about the institutions, our political system is not working. Our election system is not working. And our governing system is not working. And that is a fundamental problem in terms of getting people to have confidence in the kind of an electoral system and a governing system that we ask them to support. And I want to posit that the root cause of these problems is the amount of control over all of those systems, the election system and the governing system, that we have ceded and our governments have ceded to the private clubs, the political parties that control access to the ballot, that control how district lines are drawn, that control who sits on what committees, that control the basic functionings of the Congress. Just to add a little bit in terms of access to ballot, you know, all of us, everybody in this room, wants choices in life. We want choices in the kinds of telephones we have. You know, you want an Android or an iPod or a BlackBerry. You want choices in the kind of microwaves you can have. But we allow these two private parties to pretty well tell us, except for if you're able to jump over major barriers, that when you go to the polls in November, you may choose among all of the people in your constituency between candidate A or candidate B. Now, I don't know why we insist on more choice with the telephones we use than among the people who make our laws. But that is the way we have let our local and state and federal governments cede the power that we entrust to them to these private organizations that have as their only goal the gaining and keeping of power. So I just to add a little bit to what Jeff said, the problem in my mind, I come at it from a purely process and constitutional direction. So the problem was in the Delaware primary for the U.S. Senate, state of 1 million people, 30,000 people voted for Christine O'Donnell. And as a result, Mike Castle, former governor and popular congressman, could not appear on the ballot. The same thing happened in Utah, a state of 3 million people, where 3,500 at a convention, you know, voted for somebody other than Robert Bennett, and he could not appear on the ballot. Most of the states, by the way, now have a system whereby if you lose in the primary, you cannot be on the general election ballot, no matter how many people in the state might have preferred that candidate who lost in the primary as their first choice among the voters in the state. So in my mind, when you are elected to public office, when you're elected to Congress, as I was, you should be basing your vote on three things and three things only. One is, what do your constituents believe, prefer, what are their interests? And then, as Edmund Burke put it, you know, not to be a rubber stamp for your constituents, but to also bring to that your intellect, your experience, your thoughtfulness, your judgment. And finally, what does the Constitution allow you to do or not to do? And when you let other things enter into that equation so that you're voting because it is good for your party or you're voting because of who contributed to your campaign, you are not merely playing games with politics. You're eroding the entire democratic system. So, which to me is not about whether or not the people who come out of it are centrist or moderate. It's about whether or not you're letting voters have choice among all of the possible people they might be able to select to go to Washington and make their laws for them. And I would just say, because Justice Souter referred to this, it would be nice if you had a more centrist outcome. That is not my primary concern, because most of the great movements that have made progress in our country, the civil rights movement, the women's movement, the gay rights movement, the labor movement, were not movements from the center. So the center has no magic to it. You know, it's a matter of having principles and operating a system where the people have full choice. Redistricting, I'm just going to make this comment about redistricting. The Constitution says that, and this was a break from previous experiences elsewhere, that in this country, to be a member of the United States Senate or the House of Representatives, you must be an inhabitant of the state from which you are elected. That means that you, therefore, know them. You know their concerns. You know their preferences. Well, let me tell you very quickly what happened to me. When I was in the House, I'm a Republican, and I won in a very heavily Democratic district that had not elected a Democrat since 1928. The Democrats who then controlled the legislature, I might say the Republicans do exactly the same thing, they tried to redraw my district. So I don't know if you've been to Oklahoma, it's a big place. You know, so I went from the center of Oklahoma all the way up to Kansas and then in an upside down L halfway over to Arkansas. And I would talk about, look what they did to me. Poor me, how they redistricted me. But that's not what happened, is it? If you were able, if this thing wasn't here, you could see that I'm wearing loafers with tassels. I mean, I am a city dude. And after the redistricting, I was representing wheat farmers, cattle ranchers, small town people whose views and perspectives and concerns I didn't really understand. They were the ones who were hurt by a system that allowed districts to be redrawn according to what served the advantages of the political party. Now, just quickly to governance, Dana Milbank of the Washington Post wrote a column when George W. Bush was president, and he talked about the fact that the president was stepping out of his role as head of government to function in his other role as head of state. And I was teaching at the Wilson School at Princeton at the time, and I asked my students, what jumps out at you about that description? So is it basing rights, flyover rights, trade agreements? No, the answer is no. The president's not the head of government. We don't have a head of government. We have three separate, equal branches of government, and that separation of powers is critical to the way we operate as a free people. And what's happened is that because of the system we have, so much power is vested in the Congress. Final say over going to war, the final say over tax rates, over spending decisions, about creating or ending programs. And instead, we have a Congress that is made up from Gilbert and Sullivan, you know, the member of Parliament becomes ruler of the Queen's Navy, because I always voted at my party's call and never thought of voting thinking for myself at all. And we have Congress that your party label decides how you vote on Kagan or Sotomayor, how you vote on stimulus, how you vote on almost every kind of issue that comes up. So there are solutions. We'll get to those in other things. I favor everybody running on the same ballot. I favor the nonpartisan redistricting commissions that now 13 states have tried to do. And I favor changing the entire basic functioning of the Congress, to have nonpartisan staff, to take away from party leaders the ability to choose who sits on what committees in exchange for their promises to vote the party line, in creating a less partisan speakership, which is clearly constitutional, so maybe we'll get to some of those solutions. But in my mind, we're not going to solve the problem, no matter, we keep going back to take back our government. We did it in 2010, 2008, 2006, 2004. Nothing changes. And it's because of the system we have, which is based on the good of the party, not the good of the country.